morning that scared me. It started making a grinding noise and never came on. Since then, it's done better. Okay. All right, we are now recording. Let me hit you with a couple of things. Freddie's heard, I think you heard these, but
yeah, you did.
But Manuel, you haven't, so let's hit it with this. Just a minor thing, I don't think it'll affect either one of you. Because you're here on Monday, Wednesday is when you have class. But on Tuesday morning of next week, I have a doctor's appointment at 10, but I have to go in for blood work at 9. And that means if I came to campus, I'd have to turn around and leave by 8:15 to get back to the Kirkland Clinic by 9. So I won't be coming to campus until I finish the doctor's appointment, which I hope will be, I'll get back to campus sometime shortly after 11, okay? But normally I have class 8, 9:30, and 11, so you wouldn't be catching me anyway. I'd be in class. It's just I got to miss my first two classes, and we've arranged how to handle that. But number two, all right, for this class, I don't have quite everything up on Blackboard yet. I have your syllabus there. I got the syllabus corrected, and I put it on Blackboard, okay? However, I just didn't have a chance. I've got the research paper instructions corrected. I have the my locator card up to date, and I just haven't had a chance to put them up on Blackboard. I'll try to do that. I was going to say this afternoon, but Freddie's heard this sad story too. Friday, I was on the Birmingham campus as normal, and I happened to be the only one in the office on the Birmingham campus. My boss wasn't there, and the secretary wasn't there, so I had to handle everybody who came by looking for either one of them. I had to answer phones and deal with all this stuff. So happened to be the dean, his boss came by, and we just chatted a little while, way longer than I attended because I had plenty of work to do. But I asked her before she got away, I said, one thing I was going to ask Dr. Pruitt was, when are contracts due? Okay. And she said, oh, contracts. Oh, I forgot about those. We've been doing everything, getting ready for the beginning of the term. I forgot about those. And I said, she said, oh, well, we'll have them done sometime next week. I said, will Friday be good enough? She said, oh, yeah, Friday will be fine. Okay. And then today, while I was in class this morning, they sent an email, but I was in class. I also called Ms. Duncan and said, be sure to tell me they wanted them today. Well, I asked on Friday. No one was there. I asked the dean. She said, Friday will be fine. Then they say they want them today. So today, I will be doing contracts. So I won't probably have a chance to get your Blackboard. So I'll try. If I can finish the contracts in time, which I might be able to, then I'll go with that. And then after that, I'll try to get your Blackboard finished. I only got like three things to do. No, four or five things to do, and it'll be done. Okay? I want to put those other websites out there that either I found or other students have found said they were useful. So. All right, so that's number two. But here's the big one. I've already said it to Trady and he's declined, but for Emmanuel, your name's on this. Our math team is starting again. Were you involved with the math team last year? And you don't want to be this year? People are begging for you to. You and Trady, this level, we need people on it from this level, but you can't. You just don't want to.
What do y'all
do? Okay, basically they have competitions, okay? Last year we only had the one, okay? I hope this year we'll have more than that. The one coming up is either the first or second Friday in October, which is fairly soon, and it's going to be at Shelton State. Now, there may or may not be others. Hopefully there will be, but you know. So what we do between now and then is just practice on old questions they've asked before, and get you used to the type of thing they do, and it's basically just a good way to have fun with math, but also to get more familiar with it and you know sort of let it be second nature. So it's really a very positive thing. There's no pressure, no, you know, condemnation for anything. It's all good. It's all positive. So, you interested?
Maybe.
Okay. Miss Dracy, you know who she is on the Birmingham campus? She's actually the coach of it, but we'll have some sessions out here. In fact, Jasmine, who was in the last class, and she's also my 1 year out of the class, she's going to be participating. And the time she has free is Monday, and the time that I have free and she has free are Monday, Wednesday afternoon, 3:30 to 4:45. Now, we may not go Monday and Wednesday, we may not go the full hour and a half. But that's one practice session we're going to have out here. We could do it both days, we could do it one day, you know, whatever is convenient. She can't do it today. I can't do it today because they dumped the contracts on me today. So, but starting next Monday, you know, every Monday, Wednesday up until whenever the competition is in October. Now, Mr. Racy said she could come over here too, but if you're on the Birmingham campus, she'll be having running some practice sessions there too. So you can check with her. You know who she is, right? Are you over there?
Yeah.
Tuesday and Thursday. We'll check with her and see when she's doing her sessions. And you're certainly welcome to come to these two. We'll probably be next door. Do you have physics? What time?
Both.
Oh, you're taking both of them. So that will be while you're in physics class, so you won't be able to do this. But we'll be next door, because y'all meet here, don't you? Okay. So we'll be next door. I'll just flip places. Oh, that reminds me, I'll have to have Dr. Bryant get a computer, because he uses my computer, but if I'm going to be using it for matching, probably what we'll do then, since we'll do it that way, I'll just stay in here and y'all go back over there, because you're originally over there. So you can go back there, and then when the competition's over, y'all can come back here again. Is that too awkward? Okay, that's the other side. So please, if you can, we need your good mathematicians. Okay. Now, that took longer to talk about than I intended. Let's move on to differential equations. Oh, here we are. All right. I've got that we're starting on page 16, chapter 1, introduction to differential equations, 1.2, initial value problems, example 3, bottom of page 16. Is that where y'all have? Okay. All right, let me get my pen activated here. And this is going back to example 9 of 6, section 1.1. We saw that x equal c1 cosine 4t plus c2 sine 4t is a two-parameter family of solutions for x double prime plus 16x is equal to 0. Okay? It says find a solution of the initial value problem, which is starts off that way, but rather than just ending there, we have x at pi halves equal negative 2, and x prime at pi halves is equal to 1. All right. Now, we saw that was the solution of this before, two-parameter family. But if we have our initial conditions, now, everybody calls them initial conditions, but initial to me means first, okay? So that would be x at 0, okay, and x prime at 0. So these don't have to be initial. They just have to be at some point. So I would just call these conditions, under these conditions. Now, since you have two parameters, you need to conditions. Okay? Why do you have two parameters? It's a second degree differential equation. So you need two parameters. With two parameters, you need two conditions. Okay? So basically what we do, plug them in, plug them in. We know that x at any value, x of t is equal to this. So let's now do x of pi halves. And what would that equal? C1 cosine 4 times pi halves, right? Plus C2 sine of 4 times pi halves. What's 4 times pi halves? 2 pi, and that's 2 pi. What's sine of 2 pi? 0. Okay, so this term is 0. Okay, so now we have, let me bring it down here, C1 cosine, yeah, okay, that's not a square. That's where I crossed out before and made it a 2. Yeah, let me, I was getting confused there too. I said, there's no square there. Where did that come from? Okay, that becomes a 2. Okay. Cosine, what is cosine of 2 pi, by the way? Really?
Cosine of
2
pi?
Uh-huh.
Oh,
is 1. Okay. So that's just 1. Okay. So that's 1. And we know that's equal to negative 2. Guess what? C1 is negative 2, isn't it? Okay. How about that second condition? What do we have to do? Say again? Where do you see the equation?
Say again?
What do we need to do to evaluate that? Take a derivative of your thing. So x prime of t is equal to yeah.
Oh, okay. So it's going to be negative?
Negative. Say again?
Negative C1.
Okay. I'm going to even put a 4C1. Is that okay?
Yeah, that works.
Okay. Okay.
Sine
of?
4T.
Plus?
Cosine?
Okay, certainly going to be a cosine in there. 4t, that'll be there. Say again? 4t. 4c2. 4c2, okay, I got it. My hearing's bad. 4c2. Got it. Now let's do x prime at pi halves. And that will be minus 4, but we already know what c1 is, minus 2, right? Sine of, and we knew that to be 2 pi, but what is sine of 2 pi? 0. So this whole term's going to be 0. So who cares? We do, but plus 4 C2, we don't know what it is. And what's cosine of 2 pi? 1. Okay. And that's equal to 1. So guess what C2 is? Not negative. One fourth. You just divide both sides by 4. Because this was 0, and this thing is equal to 1. 4 C2 is equal to 1, divided by 4, C2 is Okay? So, what we do now is go back to our general form. X of t is equal to negative 2 c1, negative 2 cosine four t plus 1/4 sine four t. That's it. For any value t now, that's the one that fits those conditions. All of initial conditions, initial somehow means to be where you start from. Usually don't start at pi halves, but those conditions. Okay. See how you get it? Let's see how they did. Yeah. X equals negative 2 cosine 4t plus 1/4 sine 4t. That's the solution. Now, they have a little blurb here. Maybe I need to write this because not everybody has a book, it looks like. Two fundamental questions arise concerning initial value problem. Okay? Does a solution of the problem exist? And if it does exist, is it unique? Okay? For the first order initial value problem, and that's the problem is stated before, dy dx equal f of xy subject to y of x0 is equal to some y0. Okay? For that one, we ask for existence. Does the differential equation dy dx equal to f of xy, okay, does it possess solutions? Okay, that's the first question. Secondly, do any of the solution curves pass through the point x0, y0? In other words, when x0 is its value, the y value needs to be y0. So, number one, does the differential equation possess solutions, and do any of those solutions pass through that point, meet that condition? Okay? The second question, when can we be certain that there is precisely one solution curve passing through the point x0, y0? We may have found one, but is it the only one? That's uniqueness. Existence, does it even have a solution? And does that solution pass through the required point? Okay, that's one set of questions. Then uniqueness, is it the only one that passes through? If we find one that does, okay? Know that in examples 1 and 3, the phrase a solution rather than the solution was used. The indefinite article a is used deliberately to suggest the possibility of other equations may exist. At this point, it's not been demonstrated that there is a single solution for each problem. Next example illustrates one that has more than one solution. So this is example 4. Here's a differential equation. Dy dx is equal to xy to the 1/2. Okay? Initial condition, y of 0 equals 0. Now, to me, that looks like an initial condition. Okay? Now, y is the dependent variable, x is the independent variable, okay? Can anyone think of a solution for that?
Same question again.
Can you think of a possible solution? Y is equal to something so that the differential equation will be true plus the initial condition will be true. There's one really easy, almost trivial solution. In fact, we call it a trivial solution. Y is equal to 0. What's y prime? 0. Okay? So you, and the y prime is dy dx. I'll write it that way. Okay? Get rid of that. Okay? Now let's see. The left-hand side is 0 equal to x times the square root of 0 is 0. So sure enough, that's 0. And y of 0 is equal to 0 because y is always 0. Okay? So sure, it meets the differential equation and the initial condition. Okay? It's a pretty cheap solution, though. But it is a solution. All right. Now, the question is it the only solution? And I think that maybe we had already done this before. And we had, so let me come up with another one. Y is equal to 1/16 x to the 4th. Okay? What would y dy dx be then? No, just not plug in. Take a derivative. Uh-huh. One-fourth x to the third. Right? Okay. Now, there's your dy dx. And supposedly, that's equal to x times y, which is 1/16. X to the 4th to the 1/2 power, which of course that means something to the 1/2 power is square root. Okay, that means the square root. So that means x times what's the square root of 1/16? One-fourth. What's the square root of x to the 4th? X squared. Okay. And what's that equal to? One-fourth x cubed. Ha! That's what we got here. That's what we got there. So it fits the, that is a solution. Does it fit the initial value? Okay. So this is, y is equal to this. So if you plug in a 0, this is y as a function of x. So y of 0 would be 1/16 times 0 to the 4th power. And what is that? 0. Sure enough, it meets the initial condition. So here's another solution. Here's a solution, y is equal to 0. Here's another solution, y is equal to 1/16 x to the 4th. Okay? Both of them satisfy the differential equations, and both of them satisfy the initial condition. Okay? So we have at least two solutions. Now, at 0, 0, both of them are identical in every way, but at other values they're not. Okay? Now, without drawing this, here's their drawing of it. Here's y is equal to 0. The red line here, that's this solution. And here's the one where y is equal to 1/16 x to the 4th. Well, x to the 4th is, you know, it comes out like a parabola, but flatter at the bottom, steeper on the sides. 1/16 would not be quite as steep because it's rapidly. But sure enough, at 0-0, they do both of those solutions fail, the initial condition and the differential equation. So two perfectly good solution curves. So is this unique?
No.
There's two possible solutions that fit everything. Does it have a solution? Yes. And the solution does fit it. The boundary condition? Yes. So the existence, yeah, that's put there. Uniqueness, though, is not there. Okay.
So here is theorem 2.1. I think I'll erase this because not all of you have books. I'll write this out with a lot of abbreviations and shorthand, okay? Let R be a rectangular region in the XY plane, okay, defined by A less than or equal to X, less than or equal to B, C less than or equal to Y, less than or equal to D. Okay? That contains a point X0, Y0. Okay, so that means X0 is somewhere between A and B, and Y0 is also between A and C and D. Okay? All right? In the interior, not on the edge. So X0 is A or B, and Y0 isn't C or D. It's somewhere inside that. Okay, so actually, these satisfy that without the equal signs there. Okay. Now, if f of xy and, now you haven't gotten the partials yet, right? Partial derivatives?
Yeah.
Oh, you have?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you're also in Cal 3. Cal 3 is where we hit them. Have you had them before somewhere else?
No.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I mean, like, I know some of
you. Okay, all right. Okay. And the partial of f, that's partial of f with respect to y, are continuous. Both of these are continuous. Okay? All right. On R, on that rectangular region R. With these conditions, that implies that there does exist some interval I0 such that x0 minus h comma x0 plus h, okay, that's an interval, a portion of that, go a little bit to the left of x0, a little bit to the right of x0, as long as h greater than 0, okay, contained in AB, okay, that's why your x0 can't be on the boundary, because you have to have a little bit beyond x0, x plus h, that also is in AB, okay? And a unique solution y of x defined on I0, that's this thing we just talked about, that is solution of the initial volume value problem 2. Okay. Now, frankly, I was writing and doing, and I never got what the point was here. Okay, R is some rectangular region, XY plane. Define X is between A and B, Y is between C and D. Contain some points, X0, Y0, in the interior, not on the edge. If X of F of XY and the partial F's with respect to Y are continuous, then there does exist some interval, I0, that's between X0 minus H and X0 plus H, as long as H is some positive number, contained in the interval A to B, and a unique function Y of X defined on that interval that is solution, that is a solution for the initial value problem. There exists some interval, and there exists a unique solution such that that problem is solved. Okay, there is a solution. Okay. Now that's a lot of weasel words. Okay. So basically, what we've got is all we have to show is that f of x, y is continuous on this interval R. That's the bigger interval, a, b, and and that the partial of f with respect to y is continuous on that region R. If both of those are met, then there does exist some smaller interval, I0, where it's a little bit less than x, a little bit greater than x. Now this is on x-axis, okay? On AB, okay? If there exists this interval and a unique solution Y of X defined on that interval at I0, that is a solution. Okay. Now, let's go back to the previous thing that we had two solutions. Okay? Right now, I'm not seeing that that would have been disqualified here. The function f of x, y, which is x, y to the 1/2, no? Okay, that's where it did. Okay, remember this? Here we had dy, dx is equal to x, y to the 1/2. Okay? And y of 0 is equal to 0. That's what we're trying to meet. I was wondering, why in the world does this not qualify? Well, notice. This is a rectangular region in the xy plane there, contains a point x0, y0. If f of xy and the partial of f with respect to y are continuous on that region, well, guess what? That region cannot include any negative y values. Okay? They all have to be positive. Could contain 0, y is equal to 0, okay? But, remember it said, that it has to be, can't be on the boundary. So y equals 0 cannot be on the boundary of this, okay? But, if it is not on the boundary, that means there's something to the left of 0, and that wouldn't fit. So guess what, team? This doesn't qualify for any place where the x is getting close to 0. Because if the x, in fact, we have a good problem here, if it is equal to, well, equal to 0 is fine, but nothing, you can't have an interval on either side of x that are both in AB. Okay? So that's one of this one disqualifies, I think.
because y is equal to a negative value cannot exist. Okay? What's the y value?
The solution we said was that our y of x is equal to 1/16 x fourth, right? That was the other solution. And
y is never zero. It's never negative. So maybe that's not the reason. I was thinking x couldn't be zero, but x can be zero. Okay? Obviously it can. So frankly, I cannot see a good reason why this is disqualified. But it says if it meets these conditions, you have that. Let's say if the partial is continuous. Well, both these functions are continuous, partial with respect to y. So this thing right here, if that is continuous, there's the issue. Yeah. No, it cannot be. This doesn't qualify because the partial of this with respect to y would be 1/2 x times y to the minus 1/2. That cannot be zero. Okay? So yeah, that's why it doesn't happen. The y can't equal zero, and your initial condition is that y is equal to zero. It can't be because the partial of f with respect to y. See, this is your f. Here, f of x, y, that's your thing. That has to be continuous. It is, okay? But the partial of that would not be continuous to x equals 0. So I think that's the reason it disqualifies. Okay, that bugged me a little bit, but I think it's okay. All right. Okay. So let's look at example 5, which, I think they just did it, okay? Yeah, I didn't know they were going to do it. It looked at that very one I was talking about. Inspection of the function f of x with y, which is x, y to the 1/2, and the partial of f with respect to y, which would be 1/2, x, y to the minus 1/2, would be x over y over 2, y to the 1/2, okay? So this is your f of x. So f of x, y is equal to x, y to the 1/2, okay? And partial of f with respect to y, x and y, would equal 1/2 x over y to the 1/2. Okay? Now.
Yes.
Oh, sure. Hoping that was Victor coming in.
Okay. This is not, this is partial of f with respect to y. This is what I was saying before. Is not continuous. They are continuous in the upper half plane defined by y greater than 0. As long as y 0 is greater than 0. So if you were at x equal 2, x equal 15, x equal anything like that, no sweat, okay? They sure don't conclude this very well, do they? But y zero has to be greater than zero. Well, our initial condition has it being equal to zero. Seems like that would kick it right out. And they don't say anything about that, but I think that's what the problem is. Okay. Okay. They don't say anything more. Now, there's also, they talk about the interval of existence or uniqueness. And in this problem, that interval would have to be all x's not equal to zero, okay? So x from zero to positive infinity or from negative infinity to zero, but you could not include a value x where it's equal to zero, because if you did, then your y is equal to zero and then your partial is not defined. Now, I don't know, they don't say anything about that, but that's what the issue is, and you know, it seems like they've sort of left it alone. So, anyway, exercises for 1.2. Do number one. Do either 3 or 5 or both. Those odd answers are in the back. Okay. Do either 7 or 9 or both. Do either 11 or 13 or both. Do 15. Do any of the odds 17 to 23. Either 25 or 27 or both. And I think you could do any of the odds 29 through 33, and then either 35 or 37 or both, and any of the odds 39 to 43. I would stop there. Discussion question problems you can read through and think about, but I do not believe many, if any, of those have answers in the back. So I'd like you to be able to check. So, any questions on 1.2? I thought they sort of ended poorly there. Okay. But let's move on to 1.3. Actually, I think we're going to skip 1.3. Not that it's not a good section, but, well, actually, we'll do it. This is the thing that frustrates me about the way they do this book. Here we just talk sort of in generalities, but they're not telling you how to solve them. They're saying, here's a solution, here's this, prove that it is, verify it is, but they're not telling you how you got there. And this to me, I find just nothing short of frustration. But this is just illustrating how differential equations can be used to model mathematical issues, okay? And I'll try to go through these fairly quickly. One is population dynamics, okay? Have you by chance taken econ, the macroeconomics, or micro, either one? Okay. You did. Do you remember the name Thomas Malthus? Okay. I wouldn't have, I remembered it, but I didn't remember what he did. But anyway, one of the earliest attempts to model human population growth was by means of mathematics, was by an English clergyman who was also an economist, which seems like a strange combination, Thomas Malthus. Okay? Basically, the idea, and let me do a time out there, 1766 to 1834. And I said it seems sort of strange. Why would, in today's environment,
clergy, being economists or other things like this, it seems, no, most of the time they're not. But back then, if you think about it, or think about before this time, back during the Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, guess what? In the West, Europe and that kind of places, all the education you had was in the church. There weren't any universities to speak of. Or if there were, they were church affiliated. Because the church kept learning alive in Western Europe. It didn't exist outside of that in the Dark Ages and the Middle Ages. Middle Ages, it started being a little bit more. So it's not at all surprising that the clergyman would be the economist. They would be the, just about any kind, they were the only learned people you had, basically. Okay, not, that's a broad statement. So it's not too surprising he did. But anyway, basically the idea behind the Malthusian model is the assumption that the rate at which a population of a country grows at a certain time is proportional to the total population of the country. Let's write that down. The rate, derivative of the population as a function of time. That's what a rate is. Change of whatever you're talking about per change of time. And that's proportional to the population at any time t. Okay? So that would be an example of this. How do you change proportionality to an equation? You put in a proportionality constant. dp dt is equal to k times p of t. There's a differential equation. Not a bad assumption. I mean, not a bad model either, is it? Because if you have a very low density population, the rate of increase is going to be pretty small. You have fewer pairs of people to produce offspring. So your rates are going to be very slow. But if you have a huge mass of population, then there's lots of opportunity for growth. Okay? So that's not at all surprising that the Malthusian model, you know, is appropriate there. Okay? The simple model fails to take into account many factors which influence population growth or decline. Immigration, either people coming or going from your country. There's IM and EM, okay? EM is exiting, IM is coming in. You have disease, you have environmental conditions, you have other things. This is just based on population itself, okay? But still, turned out to be fairly accurate in predicting the population of the U.S. during the years 1790 to 1860. Okay? Now, if you think about what happened between 1790 and 1860, the U.S. was just had almost unlimited space. There was plenty of room for expansion. We had the War of 1812, but it was fairly minor. It didn't really set back population growth that badly. Revolutionary War did after 1860, war between the states really knocked out a whole bunch of the male population, wiped them slick, because it was the deadliest war that we had ever had up until I think Vietnam. I think Vietnam we finally had more people die. Even World War I and World War II in the US, fewer people died than in the American Civil War. Amazing how many people died. So, anyway, for that time, when there was few constraints to the population, we were sort of isolated, not that many people coming and going outside, yeah, it was a pretty good predictor. Here's another one, radioactive decay, okay? And they use radon gas, which is a what I studied when I worked at Southern Research Institute. Here is the assumption of radioactive decay, that the change of the amount, the rate at which the amount is changing, okay, is proportional to the amount you have, okay?
Or in other words, dA dt is equal to some constant times A. Okay? Now that's exactly the same model as we just saw. It's just that you're talking about amount of radioactive gas as opposed to a population change. This is very much more likely to be fit well because there's all these other factors that can go into population growth besides how much many people there. Agriculture. Can you feed yourself? Do you have enough land to feed yourself? Yeah, there's tons of things. Radioactive decay, it doesn't depend on anything else, okay? So that's actually a very good model for radioactive decay, okay? That could be either decay or growth, by the way. It can go the other way if K is positive, okay? If dS dt, that's where S here is some amount of capital you have, and you have an annual interest rate of R, that's the rate at which it's growing. The rate at which it's increasing is the rate times the amount that you have, okay? That's your basic equation there for basically savings, or it can be what you're owing to. Single differential equation can serve as a mathematical model for many different phenomena. All these fit the same model, okay? Now, here's another one that doesn't fit that model, okay? Newton's empirical law of either cooling or warming. Let's go to a clean slide. Okay. The rate at which the temperature of a body changes, that would be D, capital T is temperature, little t is time. Rate at which it's changing. Okay. Is proportional to, here's Newton's thing, proportional to the difference between the temperature of the body and the temperature of the surrounding medium. Proportional to T, that's the temperature of the body, minus the ambient temperature. I put T zero, while they use TM, okay. We'll do what that is. And that would be, what do they have M standing for there? Medium, temperature of the medium. In other words, let's say that when Dr. Wilson came into the room, she brought a hot rock, okay, and set it on the table, desk there. Okay, not hot enough to burn the desk, but a hot rock, and just left it there. Well, that rock is going to cool. The rate at which that temperature changes is going to be proportional to the difference between the temperature of the rock and the temperature of the room. If it was a hot rock, very hot, that temperature is going to fall off pretty quickly to begin with. But the closer it gets to room temperature, the more slowly it's going. It's going to approach room temperature very fast. Or a very cold rock, or a chunk of ice, or something like that, and brought it in and set it down. It's going to change in the other direction, warming up. But the closer it gets to room temperature, the more slower that rate of increase is going to be. The bigger the difference, the bigger the change, the larger the rate, okay? And to make that an equation, dT is equal to some K times T minus TM, okay? And that K is called the cooling rate, the constant proportionality. They don't give a name. Now, my wife's an epidemiologist. Now, I doubt if she's actually taken it back to differential equations, because as far as I know, she hasn't done a differential equation. But a contagious disease like the flu virus, by the way, time out, married to an epidemiologist, I hear these things.
Evidently, Australia has had a pretty bad flu season, okay? And usually what happens down below, because it's their winter now, they're having their winter now, that makes its way up into the northern hemisphere as well. Most of the time, it's a pretty good correlation. So stand by for a pretty serious flu season this year. Now, that's kind of the bad news. Sort of on the good news side, the types of flu they've been seeing down there are the types that we have prepared the vaccines for. So it looks like there's going to be plenty of vaccine, and generally it's going to be the right kind, because there's many different flu viruses, strains, and they can only put so much into a given shot, because they can only manufacture, you know, safely certain ones. She said the match is pretty good. But there's another hand here. It doesn't seem to be as effective. They're using the same one down there, and it just, even though it's a good match, it doesn't seem to be as effective as it is in some years. So the bottom line is, get your flu shots early. Not too early. Wait until there is a chance of flu season beginning. But get them, because the shots will only last so long, and you don't want to take them real early and then have the flu season be a late one, and then the effectiveness is worn off by the time it gets here. So there's so many things to do. But this is the situation here. All right, so here's, this is a lot more complicated, okay? The rate a contagious disease like the flu virus spread throughout a community by people coming in contact with other people. So let X of T be the number of people who have contracted the disease. Okay, we'll call it flu, okay? Now, let Y denote the number of people who have not yet been exposed. Not yet exposed, okay? Seems reasonable to assume that the rate dx dt of those who have contracted the disease, rate at which the disease spreads is proportional to, all these start as proportionalities, proportional to the, I've lost my place here. The number of people who have contracted the disease, X of T, but also proportional to the number of people who have not yet been exposed, Y of T. Okay? Seems reasonable to assume that the rate dx dt, okay, I've already said that. Okay, so this first part is how many carriers you have, the second part is how many potential victims you have, okay? So you have this interactive process there. So basically your equation becomes dx dt is equal to kxy, okay? But you see x and y are related, okay? If you have a fixed population, then those who have contracted the disease x, the ones who have not contracted would be P minus X, okay, or you know, whatever, because they're related to each other. So this gives you another issue. So if you had a population of N people, then you would rewrite this as dx dt is equal to kx times N plus 1 minus x, okay? Now that seems bizarre. They did a lot of, well, here's what it is.
Your population is in. Okay? And obviously, I can't quite justify where you get the plus one here. But what they say, X, the number of people who have the disease, plus Y, those who have not been exposed to the disease, is equal to N plus one. Now, where is the plus one coming from? I'm not sure. Suppose a small community has a fixed population of N. Okay, if one infected person is introduced into this community, so none of them are exposed, one is, that's where it comes from. One is introduced, now you have X plus Y is equal to N plus one because you had one more. So now your solve for Y, Y is equal to N plus one minus X. So then you have, that's where you get this. That's your Y value, okay. Now, obvious initial condition that would accompany that would be X of zero would equal one. At time T equals zero, your number with the disease is that one person exposed. Okay, I brought it in. All right, these are just examples of how you use differential equations. And if you hadn't caught on to it yet, anytime you see the word rate, do d by dt of whatever the rate is, okay, of whatever you're doing. Population growth, radioactive decay, amounts, money in the bank, whatever you're talking about, that the rate is ds dt, da dt, dp dt, whatever it is, okay? Dx dt if x is the number of people who have the disease. All right, here's chemical reactions. Is it time? Oh, how sad. Okay. I wish we were doing something a bit more meaningful, but later, when you have to write these things, you need to know how to translate the English to calculus, okay? And that's what this is basically doing, is a big translation exercise. So we will, I don't know if the homework exercise is here. You can look at one or three. 5, 7, stop there because we haven't gone into the chemical part yet. I don't know if they have you writing equations or what, differential equations. I think that's probably what it is, or setting up initial conditions or whatever. Look at those, and if you can do something with them, do it. All right, good deal.